Now let's take a look at Cartesian forces in 3D, okay? So we have a right-handed coordinate system, which means that, it looks like this. In 2D, the x positive x always goes this way and positive y always goes that way. That's a right-handed coordinate system. And then when you add the third dimension, it comes out of the page towards you. This would be Z coming out of the page toward you. That's obviously really hard to draw, so whenever we do this on regular paper, we do it like this, X, Y, and Z. And if you ever get confused about where the X goes or where the Y goes, remember the idea is if you're standing up here on Z, and you're looking down with your binoculars, or googly eyes, or whatever that is, the X goes to the right of the Y. So if you're looking down on it and the Y is going up, the X goes out to the right. So make sure that you've got that settled, because believe it or not, as many times as I do statics problems, every once in a while, I don't label it wrong, but every once in a while I do something silly with respect to all this. But anyway, so you've got unit vectors on your X, Y, and Z planes. So just like in X and Y, we had I hat and J hat, here we have I hat, J hat, and K hat. Those are our unit vectors in all the different directions. And so if we have a certain kind of a vector, we'll express it as its X direction in the I hat, its X component in the I hat direction, the Y component in J hat, and the Z component in K hat. And similarly to how we do this in 2D, the magnitude of A is the same thing as the square root of the sum of the squares of the X, Y, and Z components. Cute? I thought so. We have all kinds of fun doing this kind of stuff. So really where the excitement comes in is messing with these. So the idea is you've got a nice, beautiful little, axis here. Chikum, chikum, and chikum. And say I've got some kind of vector sticking out here. So this is using cylindrical coordinates. If you ever see a vector that's kind of written like this, and again, this is not in any way lined up with anything. It's just an arbitrary vector out in the middle of nowhere. A lot of times we'll kind of sketch it in. Okay, so that's kind of out in the middle of nowhere. If you measure from the X to the angle, to the force, to the vector, there you go, from the x-axis to the vector, and then from the y-axis to the vector, and the z-axis to the vector, okay? Now these are not coplanar, or these are not angles that are contained in any XY plane or XZ plane or YZ plane. These are kind of out in the middle of nowhere, okay? But you would need three full angles to define this force. And so we call this again force or vector A. We define that A, X component of A, so this X component of A is going to be defined as A cosine of alpha. And the Y component is A cosine of beta. And the Z component is A cosine of gamma. Okay? So now again, if I want to find the magnitude, it's kind of neat, I know that the magnitude is A, is also equal to square root of this, and like that. I'm going to do a quick little math proof and sneak it in on you. Like this. Like that. I square both sides. I get this. Cosine squared beta. Cosine squared gamma. And then, of course, if I cancel those out, I get that cosine squared alpha plus cosine squared beta plus cosine squared gamma is equal to 1. And so that's also a very useful little thing to have in your back pocket because sometimes it'll feel like you have four equations or four unknowns and only three equations. This is the fourth equation that a lot of times you're going to need to make this work. Okay, cool. All right. Now, if we're not using cylindrical coordinate systems, we are likely using something that's more cylindrical. Did I say spherical and cylindrical? Yeah. So say we've got this. Oh, something I did want to mention up here. If you've got a vector going off in this direction somewhere, just make sure that whenever you use this, you watch your signs. So don't just say, well, I plugged up the equation and it came out to blah. Just really make sure that you're getting what you think you're getting. And also that this gamma, that this gamma is measured from the positive x-axis or z-axis, and they're all measured from the positive, and that's the only time for that to work. They all have to be measured from there, okay? Now, this becomes more important if we're looking at another way that you can represent these. So let's stick ourselves to have another vector coming out here. Okay? And if you're learning this for the first time, what really helps me at least is to go in ahead and draw the whole kind of box. So I would go ahead and draw all this in there. Trying to make that little dot happen right there. Like that. So go ahead and draw in a whole box because that might actually help you see it better. Again, X, C, Y. Okay. So now the idea is that we're going to come in here and something might be labeled. But what will happen is it'll be labeled like this. This line will come from this corner to this corner. And this will be like maybe shaded in even. And they're only doing that for emphasis, just to kind of give you an idea of the geometry. Okay, so like that. And they'll say, okay, well, just so you know, this down here is angle theta, and this up here is angle, this up here is angle phi, whatever. So the idea, if the magnitude of this vector is A, I call this vector A, its magnitude would be A, how can I find the x, y, j coordinates? So what you want to do is you want to kind of look at this and recognize that there's a triangle, okay? And importantly, so here's my triangle that I'm going to look at. It's this triangle down here. There's a triangle here, and there's a triangle up here, basically. Hold on, let me try this again. Junk. Yeah, that was silly. I was totally drawing the wrong way. And there's this triangle. I'm going to draw another color. That's what's going on. That's why I'm confused. And then I got myself a nice little triangle here. Okay. So when you're looking at these triangles, what you need to do is you need to identify that these are right triangles. It might actually be helpful, instead of drawing that triangle down there, to draw this triangle across. So to recognize that this line here is the same as this line here, and draw in this triangle since that angle phi is given. Okay? Good. All right. So now looking at this particular green triangle first, what we want to do is we want to recognize that this is a right triangle. I feel like I've said this like five times now, I'm sorry. But what you need to identify is where the right angle is. So to identify the right angle, you got to think about the faces. So that green line is on this face. This green line is in the middle, and this green line is on the back corner. So since this is running through the middle, it's not going to be at a right angle. So the thing that's on a face and an edge, those are going to be at right angles to each other. So the face and the edge will give us a right angle. And so I can go ahead and come in here and mark this as being a right angle. Okay? Now I know my magnitude, so since that's the right angle, then this has to be the hypotenuse, right? Because any side opposite the right angle is going to be the hypotenuse. So if the hypotenuse is A, that means the adjacent side over here has to be A cosine B. And the side opposite the angle needs to be A sine B. So now that A sine B up there is the same thing as this down here, so I can go ahead and label it. Now again, I want to take a look at the blue triangle and figure out where the right angle there is. So again, I say, okay, so I've got an edge here, and I have an edge here. And I know the two edges are going to be perpendicular to each other. And so, oops, so that's how I'll identify that. And then I can go in here and I can make this a right angle. And so then again, this is the hypotenuse. Okay, so now since that's the hypotenuse, the adjacent side to the theta is going to be cosine. So it's going to be cosine theta times the length of the hypotenuse, which is A sine B. And again, opposite of the sine, opposite of the theta, that distance is going to be sine theta times the hypotenuse. So, like that. So now we can write A in terms of I, J, and K. So this is my I going in the x direction. This is my y going in my y direction, so my j hat. And then I'm going up this amount, which is the same thing as that. I'm going up a cosine phi k hat. Okay? And that's how that works. Now, what you want to be careful with in doing stuff like this is recognizing that, you know, in general, this is how kind of the standard triangles are set up, or the standard angles are set up. But, you know, what happens if I have this angle measured? Or what happens if I have this angle measured? So you want to work these all out by hand and not, don't just memorize this, because, and you don't have enough time to memorize everything you can, but I never do. I just derive it when I need it. And so I'm going to give you another example. But it's basically copy the same thing as possible. And figure out something similar just to show you, you know, how kind of how this turns out differently. Okay, so I've got this again. And I'm going to go ahead and sketch it in. There we go. Okay. Isn't that beautiful? Okay. So now let's pretend that I'm given instead this angle here. And I'm going to call it phi. Or theta, I guess. I'll go ahead and call that theta. So basically now I'm just given a different angle. And now what I want to do is I want to say, well, I also have the angle, instead of saying I know the angle from here down to there, to saying I know the angle from there down to there. I'm going to call that phi. And you can make this even more complicated if you want. But let's not, because that would not be as fun. So since that's the angle I know, now I'm going to go ahead and draw on this triangle. Okay. I want to identify the right angle. There's an edge here, and this is a face here. So that means that this, since it's between an edge and a face, has to be a right angle. Okay? So I know the length of the hypotenuse, so that means my adjacent side is cosine. So A cosine phi. And the opposite is going to be sine, so it's A sine phi. Like that. Okay. All right. So I have that, and now I'm going to identify the triangle on the bottom. Okay. And again, this is an edge, and this guy's on the face. It's an edge and a face, so that means that's where that right angle is. Do on the edge. I feel like I'm lying. I am lying. Huh. Yes, you can. This is this edge. That's not on the face. It's cutting through the center. So that's not going to work. Because these are on the same face. So that wouldn't work. So this is an edge. And that's an edge. So the edge of my cube is right there. Much better. I'm much happier with that. So, that's good. And so that means that this is my hypotenuse because it's opposite my right angle. Okay, so there's the theta. So opposite the theta is going to be sine theta times the hypotenuse, A cosine theta. And then adjacent to theta is going to be cosine theta times the hypotenuse, A sine phi. So now if I'm looking to write A in terms of its IJK components, I component, don't write this one, that's not the I component, the I hat component, the X component is A cosine sine. A cosine sine I hat. And then the Y component is sine cosine. Did I write something wrong? I did. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. There. Cosine. It's going to be cosine cosine because that's a cosine. I don't know what I was thinking. It's a cosine cosine. So A cosine cosine. And then finally A going up A sine phi k hat, and then I can work from there.